Hit it.
Hark, the bells. They chime for tacos. Oh my God. Welcome to the 1940s San Bernardino, where a couple brothers by the name of McDonald are slinging hamburgers to any sad non-LA County resident that happens to pass by. But there has to be a better way. A way to think outside the bun. Enter Glenn William Bell Jr.
That's a great name.
Born September 3rd, 1923 in Linwood, Los Angeles. Oh, that's right. LA County. That's also, I believe, where Weird Al is from.
Aren't the Beach Boys from there too?
Are they?
Aren't they from
What's
Linwood?
Going on? What's in the tacos in that place? It's in the tacos.
It's in the tacos. That's the tagline of Taco Bell. Ring is in the tacos.
Ring, taco calling. What's that? You're making money gestures to your ear? Yeah, it's a taco.
The world's smallest taco.
I'm playing the world's smallest taco for you. Glenn Bell, he was one of six kids of Ruth and Glenn Sr., or as he liked to be called, Glenn Supreme. At age five, the family moved to a farm in Oregon, but his dad was a construction worker who was often out of work. So this little five-year-old, Glenn Jr., he took it upon himself to sell cottage cheese door to door to make some money for the family. Just handfuls.
Would you like a little bit of my cottage cheese?
He had a bucket and a spoon. Yeah. He's like, how many spoonfuls do you want?
5 cents for one, a dime for two scoops.
Yeah, that just sounds disgusting. I don't trust food from kids. I especially wouldn't trust a door to door cottage cheese child salesman.
How do you feel about kids selling lemonade on a sidewalk?
I spit at them. It's Hubert's or nothing for me. No, I do like that, but usually their lemonade sucks.
Yeah.
Sorry, we say the unpopular opinions here. Unpopular opinion, children stink. After this, when he was 12, the family moved to a farm in Cedar Springs, which is right outside San Bernardino, which is a town, I kept trying to Google it, no longer exists because it got swallowed by a flood in the early 70s.
San Bernardino, that happens.
I can make money off of it. I can sell this flood door to door. Before it became the Atlantis of San Bernardino, Little Bell was selling eggs and apples and flowers from his family's farm. I buy a flower from a kid or an apple, maybe.
If he was saying, you know, God told you you shouldn't eat this apple.
Yeah, if he was trying to tempt me with it, I'll pay anything for that. The forbidden cottage cheese. He also helped his mom cook because the deadbeat dad was doing nothing. And he became known amongst his family for his really good French fries.
Okay. What Taco Bell's known for?
Yeah. It's originally called French Fry Bell. He didn't see that as a ticket success. Just yet. Not old Ding Dong Bell, as kids called him in school. Instead, starting at age 16, he took to, you're going to love this, you're about to fall in love with Glenn Bell.
All right.
He took to going on the bum and riding the rails on his school breaks from, he would ride, 16-year-old boy, riding the rails from California to Washington and Iowa, doing whatever work he would find. That was his summer.
And that's Taco Bell's food, is that it's innovative and whatever you can scrap together.
It's that hobo mentality. You might not have this tomorrow. Throw it into a taco.
What do you got there? What do you got there? What do you got there? Let's put it together in a tortilla, and then another tortilla, then chips.
Technically, it's not a tortilla, though. This is part of a bindle I fried up. So one summer, he made his way up to Tacoma, Washington, where his aunt lived, and they started selling pies together as Mrs. Dye's homemade pies.
It was Dee's.
Mrs. Dee's homemade peas. That was what they sold during the winter. It wasn't pie season, but a lot of peas. He made $3,000 in that one summer during the Depression, mind you. So selling pies as a 16-year-old hobo, that's what he was doing.
And
so,
there was an influx of hobos looking for work, too. Yeah. And this is a rich hobo. This is Richie Rich, the hobo.
People are never too poor for a pie. Everyone wants a slice.
Brother, can you spare a dime? I want to buy a pie.
So this was two hints that maybe the food industry was his destiny, but no. Instead, he graduated high school in 1941 and got a job for the U.S. Forestry Service, and from there joined the Marines in 1943.
He can cook for them.
Those boys can eat. And only one ever you throw them. So he served in the Pacific, and wouldn't you know it, he happened to be assigned working on the Solomon Islands as a chef. Wow. He got better and better as a cook, and his food became so well known that he ended up serving the higher ups when they came to visit, and he could give diarrhea to any enemy at an instant. But three hints still wasn't enough. So when the war ended, he came back to San Bernardino and bought a surplus army truck, and he started transporting bricks at 5 cents a piece. So bricks, they could be used to build a restaurant. Still nothing. From there, he got a job working for a railroad company. Then he leased a mini golf course that didn't make any money. And then he got a job at the gas company. Then he finally thought gas, cooking. I should follow what my whole life has pointed me towards and open up my own restaurant. So he bought a gas-powered fridge. He bought it really cheap from the gas company. They said he bought it. I think he just stole it from the gas company. And he sold it for profit and used that money in March 1948 to jump in on the hamburger mania in San Bernardino and opened up Bell's Drive-In. It was on Oak and Mount Vernon and was near... I know we're talking about a lot about San Bernardino, but it's where the roots are.
Okay.
Rotten as they are.
I won't flag you. I won't throw a yellow flag on this.
We get one per episode. You might want to save it because I'm about to head but the referee. So Oak and Mount Vernon, it was near a public swimming pool, so it was the perfect location for hungry swimmers and about to be cramped up swimmers to go eat. So he ran the place alone and worked from 9 a.m. to midnight cooking and serving everybody who came up. Even with McDonald's in town, it was a big hit, but it was a tiny place. So in 1952, 4 years of 15-hour days, literally over a grill. So in 1952, he decided to sell this little hut for profit and use that money to open up an even bigger hut with a high school friend named Neil Baker at the corner of North 6th and Mount Vernon Streets, and it was called Bell's Hamburgers. So seeing as how the people of San Bernardino could not eat too many hamburgers in the 1940s, this place was also a really big success. The next year, he even opened a second location of this place in Barstow. However, Bell knew that it can't last. As much as we all want to believe the people of San Bernardino eat nothing but hamburgers, he saw that more and more of these places were opening, and eventually they'd all start losing business. Yeah. The market would just collapse, as if it'd have a heart attack from eating too many hamburgers. He was sitting in the parking lot of McDonald's when he realized he had to offer something different, something that could set him apart, but he had no idea what that was. Enter the people of Mexico.
I feel like a lot of people were trying to stop them from entering. That was the problem. Can you just leave your food at the border, then you go, we'll pick up the food.
Is this just a delivery, or did you want to stay for a little bit? So across the street from his stand in San Bernardino was a Mexican restaurant called Mitla Cafe. They had been around since 1937. It's still there today, and they were pretty well known in the Mexican community in the area. Cesar Chavez used to eat there whenever he was in town. But what Bell noticed was that there was always long lines to eat there, so he wanted to go eat there and see what the fuss was all about. What he ended up having were a hot new thing called tacos.
It's weird that tacos were new.
I mean, they were new to him.
I guess I've been having tacos since an early age, so the idea of being a full-grown man having a first taco is like, oh, that's odd. But I had a gyro when I was like 27, so I kind of get it.
Which are Middle Eastern tacos.
We can all agree.
I think often, every night before I go to bed, about like maybe to our, maybe not to yours, but to my parents and grandparents, that's exactly that. I'm sure my parents didn't come to Los Angeles until they were in their 30s. I'm sure they didn't have a taco until, I don't know if my mom's ever had a taco. I have no idea.
I can call it right now. But Mom, this is urgent.
Mom, please wake up. Have you had a taco? But then we think like, oh, you know, our grandparents, they have their comfort food. They like oh, rice pudding and oatmeal and stuff. But like when we're old, like our comfort food, oh, like his grandpa's always eating a Gordita chalupa. Supreme. Yeah, exactly. Oh, gross. Yeah. Have you ever seen one of those? All he's eating are crunch wraps. Shifting taste. Let's get back on what this taco stand, everyone's going to these tacos. In particular, what they had were tacos dorados, which were tacos where you take the tortilla and you fry it into a hard shell. Along the lines of a taquito, but as a taco. You ever heard of this?
Are these towns? No.
Bell couldn't believe what he was eating, and he ate there again and again and again, trying to mouth engineer the secrets to did this.
Me and you both, brother. Yeah.
How do they do this? What is this stuff? Is this cow? But he couldn't figure it out, so he just gave up and he asked them, and they showed him how to make a taco dorado. So
that business failed, and his business thrived, and that's why you don't share secrets.
Never share trade secrets. Never tell a white man what's in a taco. Moral of the story. So now he finally had an idea that maybe this was what could set him apart from all the hamburgers and hot dog stands. Nobody was selling quick tacos dorados, least of all to the white mainstream at the time. So if he could do this right, he could do it nobody else did yet do for tacos what McDonald's did for hamburgers.
He did the Elvis Presley thing, but with tacos.
Exactly.
If I only find a white guy, black guy.
What's
music?
The Mexican equivalent? I mean, white people can steal from anybody.
Yeah.
They don't have to be black. They don't have to be black anymore.
How can I steal a taco and then sell it to white people?
How can I take this taco and make it about a puppy dog so that white people will like it? You know, I kept reading that, you know, he appropriated Mexican food. Yeah, but Mexican food's better.
Yeah. We all know, like it's understanding.
There's no competition. There's no debate that Mexican people are superior, but this isn't Mexican food that he's doing. Anyway, so the reason nobody was doing a quick version of this was that tacos dorados wasn't quick. By the way, feel free to correct my pronunciation of this.
I don't know either.
First, correct my pronunciation of pronunciation. To make these, you had to take the order, fry up the tortilla, load it up, and then it was ready. It could take like 5 minutes to do this.
Which is normal.
Really, it is. Like, I was thinking like, how long were these lines really? You were probably waiting 7 minutes.
Yeah.
But, you know, a hot dog, you take it off the thing, it's ready. So Bell realized that if he was going to make this work, he would have to have these hard shells pre-fried and ready to be filled to order. So he got a guy who made chicken coops to make him a special fryer out of chicken wire to hold pre-formed tortillas so that he could dunk several of them into the fryer at a time and then have a bunch of pre-fried hard shells at the ready for when someone came to the counter to order. The taco dorado style, obviously it's been around for hundreds of years, but the idea of having having a pre-made hard taco shell ready to go may be a Bell original, but it's also claimed by a couple people to have been invented in Texas, but there's no denying that Bell became the one to popularize this method.
Right.
Basically, old El Paso in the grocery store, you have Taco Bell to thank for that.
Yeah.
And I do thank them for that. Every time I see a box, I kneel and I salute.
Single tier and you play taps. Thank you for your service.
Thank you for your swift under 5 minute service. So he fiddled around with these hard shells for a while until he finally got it right. And then he filled it up with chopped up hamburger meat, which was cleaner to cook than frying up a messy hamburger. It was easier to do this. Put some lettuce, some cheese, topped it with his taco sauce, which was just the drippings basically from his chili burgers, like the chili burger sauce. Yeah, this is where it starts. That's where those noises start happening. It all took 15 seconds to make one of these tacos. Jeez. So he felt confident enough with this new creation that it was finally ready. So he, it's alive. He hand painted a sign.
Ah, that's where Greg comes in.
The lines are crooked, or whatever you keep saying to me every time you see a sign anywhere. It said tacos, $0.19. And he put it up next to his listings for hamburgers. Finally, a white guy in a suit came up to his hamburger hut and saw the taco sign. He had no idea what it was. So he said, give me one of those. The guy bit into it and the juices dripped down his sleeve and onto his tie. And he thought, well, that's it for tacos. This is not going to go well. But the guy loved it. All he went nuts. He hoot, he hollered. He shot his pistols, his San Bernardino pistols in the air. He said, I'm the mayor. I want another one. So he got another one. And then more people started coming and they were ordering them, getting them all in their ties everywhere until soon his tacos were outselling his hamburgers. So this is when he decided, maybe I should start shifting into the world of tacos exclusively. So he opened up a new restaurant called Taco Tia,
My Aunt the Taco,
in San Bernardino in 1954. Then he opened up two more locations in Redlands and Riverside. And between just these three places, they were taking in $50,000 a year in tacos for 19-cent tacos. He even converted his two Bell's Hamburgers locations to being basically Taco Tias as well. An early employee at his Barstow location was actually a man named Ed Hackbarth, which is the perfect name to get into the food industry.
Yeah.
Hackbarth.
Hackbarth.
He would then go on to found a direct competitor to Bell named Del Taco.
Oh, really? Interesting.
Child of the Taco. Please, I am Don Del Taco. Don Diego Del Taco. Bell was all about making things quick and efficient, so he borrowed an idea he got in the military and mowed down as many unarmed citizens. He built a shared commissary, a separate location for his several restaurants, which acted as a main kitchen. They would prepare all the vegetables, the taco shells, and the sauces, and then ship that all out to each individual restaurant where they would cook their meat on their own and insert it with all the pre-made stuff. So that sped things up even more. But Bell had intentions from the beginning of Taco Tia to turn this into a major franchise nationwide empire.
Of course he did. That's what they do. They get one successful thing like, there's going to be a Taco Bell. There's going to be My Aunt the Taco in every state. Soviet Union on top of the Berlin Wall.
The Berlin Wall will just be one long advertisement for My Aunt the Taco. What's the Berlin Wall again? Oh, we'll find out in a year or so. It's a hard-shelled wall. His plan, if it was soft-shelled,
the break right through
the
it.
The whole world would have been much better. Checkpoint Charlie, please. His plan was to sell tacos in mostly Latino neighborhoods because that way, if he was successful, any potential competitors would be like, oh, well, his tacos are selling because he's in a Latino neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And then he could start branching it to other neighborhoods. And by that time, the competitors realized, well, it's not just a Latino thing. He'd already be too powerful and too well established to fight it.
Sneak attack.
He's Bane.
He's Bane.
Let's compare the Latino community to the pit that Bane trained in. Yeah, good job, Greg.
Bane's the strongest one. He broke Batman's back. It's good. It's a good comparison.
It's like the Mexican people will break the back of the white man. I mean,
rich white men.
So this was the first step in his plan for world domination. But then, like we said, Bane. But then he did branch into a non-Latino community and built another Taco Tia in Pasadena, and it did not do well. Yep. They were not ready for that.
You mean Pasadena doesn't like other cultures coming into them? That's weird.
They were trying to arrest the building itself. Why is it speaking Spanish at me?
I told you. No Spanish here. Taco Tia, get out.
In English, just yelling at a closed building sign. In English, this put Bell at odds with his partners in Taco Tia, who didn't want to risk expanding into the Los Angeles area. So Bell cashed out of Taco Tia in 1956 and finally came back to the city he came from, the city of Angeles, Los. So he was going to open up a whole new taco chain in LA, and it was going to be successful because if he did it once, he could do it again.
Yeah.
Watch me. But he needed some partners once more. Luckily, some players from the LA Rams trained near a Taco Tia and they loved the food. So they were interested in investing in a new taco place by the same guy. So them and a couple others joined Bell. And in 1958, he opened El Taco.
Almost
when I read that, I know it's Taco Tia. No.
No.
El Taco. No.
No.
Del Taco. No. When I read,
but maybe.
When I, well, maybe one day. When I read that with the LA Rams, I was like, wait a minute. They just came 2 years ago, and I realized, oh, yeah, there were other words.
You're a pretty smart guy.
It takes Taco Bell's only 2 years old, right? Is it too late to invest? So I'm not sure exactly where this first El Taco was, or any of the El Tacos were, but by 1962, there were four of them.
Okay.
But by then, Bell realized, I don't need partners. Like, I'm the one.
Yeah.
I don't need to share this with anybody. I don't need to take their input. He's proven three times now that he could open up a successful taco chain.
Yeah.
So now he wanted to finally create the big one he'd always dreamed of. So in 1962, he cashed out of El Taco and bought a plot of land at 7112 Firestone Boulevard in Downey.
Downey.
He built a whole plaza there in a fake Mexican style called Plaza Guadalajara. My favorite part of Mexico.
My favorite part of Mexico is actually Downey, California.
My favorite state in Mexico is Plaza Guadalajara. So it was like a few open air stores, but the main attraction was a little 20-foot by 20-foot food stand. 20-foot by 20-foot stand.
He build a whole plaza and then just sneak Taco Bell onto there?
Yeah, he built a whole plaza to draw you in, but like
the main draw was
come eat the food.
He Trojan horsed it.
That's cool. Taco Bell's.
That's Taco Bell. That's how I eat the food too.
That's Taco Bell in a hard shell. So it had no indoor seating. It was just a counter you ordered at and a patio with some fire pits for the nighttime. But what should Taco Man Bell call this Taco Bell stand of his? Let me say that again. Yeah. What should Taco Man Bell call this Taco's top?
Oh my God.
What should Taco Man Bell call this Bell's taco stand of his?
Near the city of Bell.
Near the city of Bell, where tacos. What are we talking? A friend suggested he should combine his name with his passion. So Glenn Entrepreneurship was born.
Glenn murdering people by the highway.
Glenn, I don't need any partners anymore, so I'm cashing out, was born. March 1962, the very first Taco Bell opened. The menu consisted of a taco, tostada, frijoles, and a Bell Burger, which was just a hamburger made of taco meat. Everything cost 25 cents each. Their logo, it was this weird interpretive image of a guy sitting on top of a bell wearing this huge sombrero, and it kind of looked like a Coco Pelli. Very precarious. It's okay. Very weird.
Yeah.
It was
surreal imagery.
Oh my God. I was tripping bolitos when I looked at this. It was a hit because everything he does, people want tacos. That street it was on was a pretty busy thoroughfare at the time, so a lot of customers were coming. The area was also an aerospace hub, so it's safe to say that most of the early space work and the lunar landing was powered by Taco Bell. In space, no one can hear you, Caro. In just 6 months, they opened up a second location in Long Beach, then in Paramount, Gardena, Altadena, Pasadena,
snuck whatever. Back into Pasadena.
Yeah.
You know, the way into Pasadena is to start something in Altadena and then be like, oh, you know, over there on Lake and whatever up there by the mountain, they like it over there. Yeah. Then we want it over here.
The way to Pasadena's heart is through Altadena. What is going on with me? I took an extra strength DayQuil before
That's what's happening.
And what I didn't quite realize is that I have allergies.
What you didn't realize was that it was a NyQuil.
What you didn't realize is that I laced it with arsenic. And you have 4 minutes to finish the story. Each of these new locations, they each had their own grand openings with salsa music, free sombreros, but no salsa because that's a little too much.
It's not that authentic.
The salsa is just ketchup. But the real money came from franchising in Taco Bell. In 1964, the first franchise Taco Bell opened in Torrance. It was run by a retired LAPD officer named Kermit Becky.
Okay, what was the real name, though?
Muppet Baby. You want me to do my Kermit impression again?
No, we're good.
This first franchise run by Kermit, Taco Bell by Kermit, was taking in $10,000 a month starting in the first month. So from there, franchise crazy. He used to be great at French fries. Now he's good at franchise.
That hurt my teeth to hear. Go ahead.
Because you can really sink your teeth into that pun. They became so big that in 1966, they went public on the Pacific Stock Exchange, and that gave them more financing to expand more and more and more. In 1967, just 5 years after their first location, they opened up their 100th restaurant in 5 years.
It's an explosion of tacos.
It's almost as if the market ate a Taco Bell taco and then had some sort of explosion.
Some sort of reaction to it.
By 1970, there was 325 locations.
All across the Southland?
All in Downey.
You could actually open one up in every apartment that's there. It's weird.
They considered any kitchen to be a Taco Bell. But you can't get that big without someone noticing. And the Pepsi Corporation has many spies with many eyes. And also they have Pizza Hut, who in the late 60s tried to open up a competitor to Taco Bell. Did you know this?
No.
You know like how Carl's Jr. has the green burrito?
Yeah.
Pizza Hut had the Taco Kid, but it failed.
What year was this?
Late 60s.
Okay. Yeah, I remember. remember.
You remember going down to the old Five and Diamond and on the way home talking at the Taco Kid?
Yeah, the Taco Kid on my way to the A&P and the Piggly Wiggly.
You were going home to watch the Kennedy assassination.
This is a sequel.
I need some tacos.
I hope it's Ted this time.
Who's it going to be?
Who's it going to be?
First reality show. Fallen American Idol. Obviously, it failed. So Pepsi decided, let's spend a ton of money and just buy Taco Bell.
That's fine.
Which is exactly what they did. February 1978, $125 million. They bought Taco Bell.
That's, you know how many more Taco Bells I could open with that money?
You know how many gorditas I can buy? That's also why they're often, I never understood this, but now it makes sense. Taco Bell's and Pizza Hut's in the same building because they're both owned by PepsiCo. Yeah.
Does Pepsi own Mountain Dew?
Are you talking about the Baja Blast?
Or are you going to cover that? Is that the next four pages?
Yeah.
Baja Blast?
I'm going to do a deep dive into Baja Blast right now. I hope you don't mind.
I brought a scientist friend.
I mean, they must. I think if you look, Pepsi owns everything.
Yeah,
everything we're talking about tonight, I'm pretty sure is owned by Pepsi.
This episode is brought to you by Pepsi.
Oh, forgot to mention. Brought to you by Coca-Cola, which is owned by Pepsi. So it's Yum Brands, Inc., which is the restaurant division of PepsiCo. They run pizza and Taco Bell and everything else.
They also run whatever slavery ring is running through.
They run Pizzagate. They run Pizza Hut, Pizzagate, Taco Bell.
You know, it started as a subsidiary of Pizza Hut. I don't know what went wrong.
They tried to branch out into more children associated, like, sort of like a Chuck E. Cheese sort of thing.
We were selling cages. We were selling kids. And then what do you know?
Look what happened.
Look what happened.
Somehow, here we are at the midterm elections. He had built a Taco Bell. Bell had built Taco Bell. This is too much to be saying on Extra Strength Dayquil.
Yeah.
He built Taco Bell into an 868 location mega chain, but this was the end of the line for old Ding Dong Bell. He recognized his limitations as a businessman, and he said he knew when to let go. So he retired from the taco industry after this sale, but not before helping a friend of his named John Gallardi open up a place we talked about in a previous episode, Der Wiener Schnitzel. Mm. It's all coming together.
Yeah, this is what I live for. This is the Marvel mashup I've been waiting for.
His dream was to open up a Taco Bell theme park, and he even bought land in Florida to open up this theme park, but it fell apart.
I hope so.
Literally, the land fell apart. He did have a place called Bell Gardens, not that one, near his house in Rancho Santa Fe, but it was mostly just a farm that you could visit.
I'm also okay with that.
That closed in 2003. When I read Bell Gardens, I was like, wait a minute.
That's already a thing.
Yeah. Is Bell Gardens a subsidiary of Pepsi? Does this corruption scandal go even deeper? Say what you will about Glenn Bale. Appropriation of Mexican food. And we already have. Yeah. But Taco Bell was a lot of people in this country's first exposure to quote unquote Mexican food.
Yeah, gateway food. Gateway taco.
That's something. That's at least something to make people vaguely aware that there's other cultures out there than McDonald culture. You know, it's something.
It's something. I don't hate Taco Bell. I eat it.
I don't hate it. In fact, I love it. It's my favorite Mexican food. He showed them that a taco had all the same ingredients that a hamburger did. Beef, cheese, tomatoes. It was just made a different way. And in the end, aren't we all just hungry people eager to get diarrhea no matter what shape our beef comes in? Vote no on prop diarrhea.
That's your Thanksgiving message. Yeah. Aren't we all just really hungry and want to poo?
Don't we all just have irritable bowel syndrome? Let us eat.
I'm thankful for IBS. Aren't you? Oh, it's only me?
I am thankful that I can be so open with all of you about my IBS. So Glenn Bell died on January 16th. IBS? 2010.
Wow.
Not that long ago, but Taco Bell didn't. That sale back in 1978 kicked things up a notch. A Del Scorcho of flavors. What's the name of their, do they have a hot sauce? Honestly, I have not eaten.
Fire,
they have it. I do not have a lot of experience with Taco Bell at all. I love their cinnamon twists, but other than that, I really haven't eaten much there.
It's sort of a punchline among comedians that it's almost like an avant-garde fast food where they're willing to throw anything together. That's like the punchline about it, but I'm a fan of it. It's one of those restaurant chains that I just didn't grow up with. There wasn't one near me, so I was in high school did we get a Taco Bell mixed with the KFC near us, and I was like, okay, well, I'm going to eat this all the time because there's a lot of sour cream in it.
The Mexican fast food I got was Del Taco.
Yeah. Okay, well, we're just two boys growing up in different parts of town. That's all.
You came from the wrong side of the shell.
That's almost good.
That sale back in 1978 drove Taco Bell national. It also seemed to drive them insane because from then on, Taco Bell slowly morphed into the manic mutant of Mexican mush that we all know it is today. Here, we're getting to it. First off, the kind of weird racist logo had to go. They changed it to the bell that we all know.
Yeah.
Ding, ding, ding.
Fair. At least somebody's willing to stop a racist logo.
Yeah.
Take a hint, sports teams.
Maybe we should change the Redskins into, I don't know, a taco?
Hey, it's better.
Then it was off to the races. Not the racists. More and more locations kept opening. Their biggest competitor at the time was Nagel's. Do you know them?
No.
It was actually started by one of the partners from Del Taco. And in 1983, they had 160 stores making $84 million. That was their next biggest competitor. Taco Bell had 1,600 stores making $918
million. So, like, so
there was,
not a
there
competitor.
Was no competition. Yeah. The first international location of Taco Bell opened in London in 1986.
They must not know what the hell that is. That's so far removed from everything. They don't even know what bells are. Do they have that in old-timey London?
They call them dingawobbles. They have to to change the name. What's this Banger Dingle Waffle? They got even stronger in the late 80s when they streamlined their entire operation. They started preparing most of the food off-site and shipping it into each location, which allowed for two things. First, they were able to take the layout of their restaurants from 70% kitchen to 30% dining room. Flip that, now it's 30% kitchen, 70% dining room, because they're not cooking the food there. Just the meat, but nothing else is really made, if you could call it meat.
You gotta bring that cow in.
Yeah, they got rid of the slaughterhouses that was in each Taco Bell. So now more customers could be in there, but also by doing most of the cooking off-site, they were able to drop down their costs so low that they could offer prices even lower. So they started offering a discount menu in 1988, which as far as I could tell, made them the first fast food place to offer such a thing. They took this even further in 1990 with their 59, 79, 99 cent value menu offered in, at that time, 3,273 locations.
Yeah.
So it was moves like these that had Taco Bell doing better business than McDonald's in the early 90s.
Yeah.
So they started opening up counter versions of Taco Bell in airports and sports arenas and even in supermarkets where they started selling Taco Bell brand taco shell salsa and beans in 1993. Around this time, they also gave up completely on having company-owned locations, and now it's just franchising. Okay. So they sold off their company locations to franchisees. So you guys just take care of everything.
Take the name. Give me,
yeah. Yeah. I'm playing the world's smallest taco. You know what that means. Money's coming. When you see a taco weep under the moonlight, that means money's coming in your future. So we know Taco Bell's popular, but their secret weapon is their marketing and the constant food experimentation.
Yeah.
So let's start with the marketing. In 1989, they became the first fast food chain to link up with a blockbuster movie to cross promote. Guess the movie.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
No.
Bill and Ted.
No. 1989.
Oh, Batman.
Yeah.
Was it really?
It's Batman.
How?
Well, because we were talking about Bane before. You know, they cross-promoted, like, Batman eats...
Oh, I see. So you Batman watch a Taco Bell commercial, and it's got Batman in it for some reason.
Exactly.
But there's no Taco Bell in Gotham City.
No. They went with Del Taco for that one. They were in Nagel City.
Bruce, we don't have time!
There's always time
for Nagels. Their catchphrases, they started with, make a run for the border.
It's funny. Then not really, though. I hope that got scrapped really quickly.
That lasted for, like, 20 years.
Sheesh.
Then they had the cure for the common meal, which I feel like was something from Mad Men. Then in 1997, they brought in a little chihuahua named Gidget, and the voice of a man named Carlos Alazraki.
Yeah, he does a lot of voices. He does Rocko's Modern Life.
Really? Who is he in Rocko's Modern Life? You're joking.
No, he's also in Reno 911.
He's Reno 911. Yeah. I know that. Are you kidding me? He was Rocko?
Yeah.
So it was a new series of commercials with the catchphrase, Yo Quiero Taco Bell. Mm-hmm. These commercials only lasted 2 years because they wanted to change their company image to being more about fresh ingredients and having a dog with plenty of usable meat on it as a spokesperson they felt was not the right path to go with. Let's not draw the parallels any further.
Yeah, let's stop it right there.
Yo Quiero human rights for a dog. In 2003, they actually lost a lawsuit against two guys who said the chihuahua thing was their idea. From there, they changed the slogan to think outside the bun, and today it's Live Moss. Gidget the Chihuahua didn't get turned into a chalupa, but instead lived on a level of fame none of us will ever achieve. She appeared at Madison Square Garden. She was in Legally Blonde 2. She opened up the New York Stock Exchange one day, and she was in a Geico commercial in 2002.
I remember that. Like, I remember some commercial
campaigns. Watching the stock market open that time.
I was distraught. I mean, orange juice was down or whatever the hell they measure by. Whatever they're looking at.
The breakfast market, because it's in the morning.
Yeah, I remember that commercial campaign and hating every second of it. It happens. You hate it. Then there's parodies and you hate those. And you're like, this won't end.
She retired to a life, Gidget, of leisure in Santa Clarita.
Oh, cool.
Until she had a stroke at the age of 15 in 2009. We lost Gidget.
No.
Yo quiero military funeral.
Yo quiero immortality.
Yo quiero rosebud. The world's smallest tacos playing in my ear again. They also had a lot of gimmicks that got a lot of people excited. Like in 2001, when the Russian Mir space station was going to crash back into Earth, they put a big tarp in the ocean off of Australia that had a bell for a bullseye and said free taco here. And if it crashed into the Taco Bell tarp, they promised to give everyone in the United States a free taco.
Wow.
It did not hit. So everyone in the country was forced to eat a bowl of borscht.
And I starved that night.
Never walk over my jokes again. So in 2007, they had the Steal a Base, Steal a Taco promotion that everyone in the U.S. would get a free taco for each stolen base in that year's World Series. I know. I feel like I could go into a Taco Bell on any day of the week and I would get a free meal.
Probably.
And not just because of who I am. They were even able to turn bad press to their advantage when in 2011, a class action lawsuit against them claimed their beef was only 35% actual beef. They countered with an ad campaign that said, thank you for suing us, and touted that their beef, it's actually 88% beef. And the lawsuit was dropped.
You can't argue with that logic. No, that comedic
can't.
Logic.
Hey, you can't argue with math. And then there's the second part of their success. They're crazy menu items. There's the classic, like the Crunchwrap Supreme came out in 2005. Mountain Dew Baja Blast in 2004. Then there were things like the Beefy Fritos Burrito, which has Fritos in it. The Double Decker. So I guess it is called that. I scolded you earlier.
You did.
Not called Double Deckers. They're called Chalupa Loopas.
You spit on my shoe. And you said, you call yourself Mexican American? How dare you? Cesar Chavez is rolling in his grave because you don't know what Double Decker
Taco is. The Double Decker Supreme Taco, which is a hard shell taco, layer of beans, then a soft tortilla. Seven Layer Burrito. The Cheetos Burrito. The Naked Chicken Chalupa, which is a taco with fried chicken as a shell. The BLT Taco. The Firecracker Burrito, which had savory pop rock exploding things in it. The Chocodillo, which was a Kit Kat quesadilla, which I really wanted, but killed too many kids or something. In 2014, they started serving breakfast with things like the Naked Egg Taco, which is a taco with a shell made of fried eggs. Waffle Taco, you can fill in the blank. French Toast Chalupa.
It's like a lot of these are dares, and like people are like, oh, can you imagine they did it? I bet you won't get one. I bet you won't get one. And they sold two tacos that way. That's like on purpose. Like,
well, you'll hear how successful some of these things. March 2012, after 3 years of testing, they came out with the big one, the Doritos Locos Taco. Their biggest hit until earlier this year when they unleashed Nacho Fries, which was their most successful product launch in Taco Bell history. They sold over 53 million orders in 3 months. That's a lot of friends daring a lot of friends, isn't it, Greg?
These people, you don't have a lot of friends.
Yeah. You don't have 47 million friends. All that being said, they were also the first fast food place to offer a section of their menu approved by the American Vegetarian Association, which is just like a plate of tortillas. In 2014, they opened up an experimental, slightly more upscale version of Taco Bell in Huntington Beach called US Taco Co. That was Day of the Dead themed. It closed in a year. They got to learn, stop opening these experimental restaurants in places like Huntington Beach and Pasadena. They also opened a cantina style version in Chicago called Taco Bell Cantina. But that one original location where it all began, it closed in the 80s and became a few other mom and pop taco places over the years until 2014 when it became abandoned. It was going to be demolished, but the developer of the land let the Downey Conservancy know. So they're able to work with Taco Bell to save the building, which they transported on the back of a truck in November 2015, late one night down the 405 to the Taco Bell headquarters in Irvine. People just driving up to it, trying to order.
Is that the original Taco Bell?
Wait a minute.
Hey,
did that used to be a Taco Tia? Today, Taco Bell sells over 2 billion tacos and 1 billion burritos a year, taking in about $10 billion every single year. Some of that goes towards their Taco Bell Foundation for charity and the Live Moss Scholarship, which I keep applying for. All this coming from their over 7,000 locations worldwide on every continent but Africa and Antarctica. One place there's no Taco Bells, Mexico. In 1992, they thought it was time to break into the motherland and opened up a few locations. They all closed within 2 years.
Yeah.
Then they tried again in 2007, opening up a location in Mexico City, but this time not pretending to be actual Mexican food, because the first time around, nobody understood what any of the food was. So this time they renamed stuff, like calling crunchy tacos tacostadas. This lasted 3 years and they haven't tried since. One food critic in Mexico said that trying to bring Taco Bell into Mexico is like bringing ice to the Arctic. This is why Taco Bell doesn't try to pass itself off as Mexican food anymore, but instead as Mexican inspired food.
And that's all they needed to say from the beginning.
Don't pretend. Don't even pretend it's Mexican anything anymore. This is just, I don't know what this is.